The internet is full of bro science, fake knowledge, half information or propaganda. Your quest of reliable, authentic health information ends here. So subscribe this channel and hit the bell icon and you never have to go anywhere else ever again.
Hello everyone, how are you today? I'm Dr. Paramjeet and you're watching Dr. Education. Welcome back. This is Her Health series, right? We are talking about her health. Matlab, females, who, what happens in females and diseases about females, problem, health problems of females, right? So today we are going to discuss about premenstrual syndrome, PMS. Yes, it's a very common problem. It has a wide range of symptoms, right? It's basically the problems, health problems which females face during and before, even before they have a menstrual cycle, right? So sometimes, you know, symptoms can start during the second half of menstrual cycle. That means the whole 28-day cycle, it can start after 14th day or more into the first half. And sometimes it starts after first day of your bleeding, first day of last menstrual bleeding, that's the thing. But the point here is, what causes these symptoms? What are the symptoms? How they happen? What can you do about it? All these things will be discussed today. So let's start. Right. Remember, usually premenstrual syndrome is basically a syndrome. Syndrome is something which we call for a set of symptoms or set of problems, right? And it's premenstrual, so it comes before the menses, before the menses starts. And once the menses starts, it will basically, the problems usually go away in 1 or 2 days. Remember that. So most important question is why it happens, right? Why premenstrual syndrome happened, and then we'll see what exactly happens. So first thing, many problems happen during these times, and number one thing is the hormone levels, your hormone levels, which is secreted directly controlled from your brain. So brain hormones which are there, and their abnormal levels, little bit of abnormality can cause a lot of problems in the body. And that's why everyone will have a different level of these hormones. So that's why everyone will face different set of symptoms, different intensity of symptoms during these premenstrual syndrome. And this syndrome can also be related to other factors like psychological factor, social factor, cultural factor, biological, and even your physical issues. You mean you're not fit, you are obese, you are depressed, you are shy, you are anxious, you are angry. So all these things actually affect your symptoms in these kind of things. So, and this premenstrual syndrome, usually many women, they will have these problems during their, obviously, during the childbearing age, obviously. And but they are more common in people who are patients, females who are 20 or late in their late 20s or in their late 40s, late 20s, late 40s, and in women who have at least one child. Once you have a child, you can start having these PMS, and it's not exactly necessary, but that's more common in these people. Then if you have any kind of depression or any family history of depression, any family member of depression, still you can have more chances of PMS. And if you have post delivery mood disorder, sometimes after delivery, after pregnancy, your mood changes, you're more anxious, you're more sad, sometimes that also leads to PMS, worsening of PMS. And the symptoms often get worse in their late 30s and then late 40s as the menopause approaches. So PMS will increase over time whenever it happens. So what is this? What are we talking about? What are the symptoms, right? What is this PMS, right? In PMS, what happens to your body? Number one, you can have many symptoms, but you can have, everyone will have a different set of symptoms. But what exactly, what are the common thing which happen? Number one, you can have bloating. Kind of bloating or feeling gassy. You feel a lot of gas in the abdomen, in the stomach. You can have breast tenderness. You can have clumsiness. You can have drowsiness. You can have constipation, diarrhea. You can have food cravings, right? You can have headaches, and you can also have a very less tolerance to noise or even light, right? Photophobia, phonophobia, which is called, right? And even sometimes many people can have confusion, they can have forgetfulness, they can have trouble in studying, concentrating, fatigue, feeling very slow, sluggish, right? They can have all these symptoms. Even irritability is seen, aggressiveness is seen, hostile environment, hostility is seen, outbursts of anger is seen sometimes, right? Sometimes you feel anxious, stressed. These all things, sometimes sadness, hopelessness can happen. Even you can lose your sex drive, or sometimes, rarely, you can even increase, it can increase your sex drive also. Mood swings can happen, judgment can be impaired, poor judgment can happen. And even you can feel a little guilt, fear. Sleep problems can happen. You can sleep very little, or you might be sleeping a lot. So these are all related to imbalances, hormonal imbalances, right? So what can you do? Number one, you get a health checkup. Complete medical history, complete medical exam, including pelvic exam, is done to find out if there is any correctable reason, something which you can correct apart from hormones, right? If there is any other physical problem in infection, pelvic inflammatory disease, any fibroid, any other thing which can be treated. First thing is to find out if there is anything like that. And you can maintain a symptom calendar, a diary, which can help you identify what is your most troublesome symptom, which problem is troubling you the most, right? This can be written down on a calendar or a diary. This can help even confirm the diagnosis of PMS, right? So what is the treatment? How can you help yourself, right? Number one is, you obviously need to keep a diary, keep a log of at least for at least 3 months. You have to do that and record your types of symptoms. You have to record how severe they are. You have to record how long they last. This is important. This will help you and your doctor find the best treatment for yourself. So first and the biggest treatment is lifestyle changes, so that you can actually control the brain signals or hormones levels. And yes, they are controlled by basic things, obviously, right? Number one basic thing is plenty of water, plenty of liquids in your diet, juices, water, milk, anything, right? So, but you have to avoid soft drinks, alcohols, and other beverages which have caffeine. You have to avoid them and eat more, have more simple drinks, simple liquids. That is important, right? And this will reduce your bloating, your fluid retention, as well as many other symptoms. Many times, only this can solve the problem. Yes. And then second thing which you can do is small frequent meals. You have to you have to eat every 4 hours, every 3 to 4 hours, and you have to avoid overeating. Remember, so you have to eat more vegetables, eat more salad, and you have to have a balanced diet all over, right? You have to have whole grains, vegetables, fruits, yeah, normal proteins, dairy, all these things in your diet, and limit your salt and sugar. Salt and sugar, you have to decrease your salt, sugar, sweets, biscuits, right? All these things, you have to decrease them. And you might have to take nutritional supplements depending upon your examination. Your medical exam will give us ideas what kind of nutritional supplements you need. Maybe you might need vitamin B, B6, B12, calcium, magnesium supplement. These are, or sometimes other kind of medicines can be given, like tryptophan, which is found in dairy products, right? Tryptophan can be found in, and that can also be given, and they are found to be very helpful in many cases. That's why supplements are given. Many times your doctor will start you on multivitamins. They are helpful, right? And exercise, regular exercise, which is aerobic exercise, right? Cardio exercise, running, jogging, swimming, cycling, whatever you can do, right? That is very helpful. And if you do it throughout the month regularly, maybe 5 days a week or maybe every day, that is good, right? 1 or 2 days off is fine. Do that. This will actually reduce the severity of your symptoms. Every single symptom will decrease because of this, right? This obviously becomes a little more hard during the times when you have PMS. But when you don't have PMS, when you don't have any symptoms, that's the time to exercise to make sure you do not get symptoms in future, right? Then, next big thing is sleep. Yes, you have to change your nighttime habits so that you don't have decreased sleep. You have to sleep for 7 to 9 hours. 6 is minimum. 6 is the minimum, but 7 to 9 is good, right? You have to sleep for that. Try changing your schedule so that you get that amount of sleep, proper sleep. You don't get awakened in the middle of the night. That is important, right? If you cannot get that, you can get this 7 to 9 hours in two slots, right? One in the night, one in the afternoon, whatever is comfortable to you, but you need to have your sleep. Then if you have headaches, if you have backaches, if you have cramps, breast tenderness, then you can take medicines sometimes, right? Painkillers, right? Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like brufen, naproxen, or acetaminophen, right? Avoid paracetamol, avoid aspirin, right? Avoid that, or make sure to discuss this with your doctor if you are needing these medicines very often. Don't take it daily, don't take it very regularly for the whole month. That can lead to severe gastritis, stomach ulcers, other side effects, right? So remember, then you can go for oral contraceptive pills, birth control pills. They also decrease, sometimes decrease your PMS symptoms. But remember, in a few people, in some people, if they are already on birth control pills and they have high symptoms, they can, some of the few people can have increased symptoms also because of birth control pills, because they are hormones, right? You are taking hormones to balance your hormones, but maybe sometimes that hormones can interact with your own hormonal levels and cause severe problems. We have to see. You might get relief, you might not get relief. So birth control pills can be tried under supervision of a doctor. In severe cases, in what you do, we give medicines for something like depressions. If they are there, then they are also helpful. Antidepressants, sometimes like SSRIs are given, which are the first hand thing, which obviously your doctor will give you, and you can go for your anti-anxiety medicines also. Some diuretics are given by doctors. If you have a lot of fluid retention, bloating, breast tenderness, etc., weight gain is there, then you have doctor will give you a plan to decrease your weight, cut down your carbs, etc., exercise. All these things are important. So remember, PMS, most people, if they are treating themselves under supervision, they will get a very good relief. So it does not cause that much of a functional abnormality. So, they can be very well managed if you know how. But depression is a big issue which happens in women, and that can complicate symptoms. So that's why you need to take help. You need to discuss this with somebody in your family as well as your doctor. So if your problem is not going away, even with self-treatment, if your symptoms are so severe that your actual ability to function, your daily life has been decreased, or if you feel like you want to hurt yourself, that's the time, that's kind of high time. You have to go to a doctor or discuss this in your family and then go to a doctor. This is a very easily controllable problem. So don't hesitate and don't worry. You're not going to die because of it, but you have to be happy here. That's the idea. So this is all about premenstrual syndromes, premenstrual bloating, etc., etc., PMS. Don't hesitate to share this video. It is important and it is a good video. So make sure to give me a thumbs up. I'm Dr. Paramjit. You're watching Dr. Education. Stay connected, guys. Stay healthy.